Moments of silence now as to give, as God's people, we pray. Since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, looking to Jesus in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we as His gifts sing against thy power, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, weakness, sorrow, and comfort. We are heartily sorry and take all our sins. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and thy Father, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve thee in the innocence of our life, to the glory of God.
Glory, 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 glory Takes away your coat, do not withhold evil.
Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Initially obvious. It wasn't clear to begin with that DNA was the recipe for life and his structure of the little helix. Nor was it clear how the elements related to one another or what the equations of the universe were. Each one required a moment of insight. Each one needed a scientist to see the universe, our world, in a new and different way, throwing off old preconceptions, abandoning outdated presumptions, ditching ideas that no longer worked, and replacing with a more accurate, more appropriate picture of how things actually are. And so we learn to see God's creation in a new and clearer and better way. It wasn't the scientists, though, who first encouraged us to see God's creation in a new, clearer, better way. In his ministry, in his teaching, Jesus opened our eyes to a fresh way of encountering the world. For centuries, it had been assumed that the warped, the revolting, the gross, none of these things had a place in God's kingdom. But then, suddenly, shockingly, along comes Jesus, reaching out his hand to touch, to hold the infested, infected, festering flesh of the leper. Because sickness isn't a moral failure, a barrier between humanity and God. Here is Jesus pressed in on every side by the crowd, scandalously to the police, searching out for the woman with the flow of blood, but socially awkward medical issue, reaching out to comfort her and reassure her. Because there's not one aspect of human existence, even the most embarrassing, that's beyond the care of our loving God. And then there is Jesus, revolutionary, declaring that all foods are clean, even those that are Jewish minds and tastes are used to eating pork and shellfish, seem loathsome and disgusting. Because everything, even those things that make us feel a bit queasy, everything in our world has been formed by our Creator God. And then in today's gospel reading, we hear Jesus' words commending, blessing those whom society so quickly consigns to the scrapheap, the poor. Maybe those who are homeless, dishevelled, unwashed, who huddle in doorways or hunker down in the tube stations, begging for money and making us feel uncomfortable. The hungry, perhaps the distressingly emaciated figures we see on our TV screens as we hear reports of yet another famine. Starving children who make us want to close our eyes or turn our faces away. Those who weep, weeping through loss or pain or disappointment. People whose grief makes us feel awkward, wishing that they really weren't there at all. Such people, says Jesus, are blessed. They're precious and beloved in God's eyes. They're the very ones in whom God wants to pour out his unconditional love and divine blessings more than we can imagine. Not only is this the season of Halloween, not only has it been the week of our cathedral's light show, but on Tuesday we'll be celebrating the feast of All Saints. And as I think about the saints of old and the saints of today, I can't help feeling that they were also those who saw the world in a new and clearer and better way. I think of people like St. Francis who weren't afraid, not just to associate with the poor, but to live in poverty himself. I think of people like Mother Teresa who left her religious life, put on her blue-edged sari and went to live in the slums, teaching the forgotten children and caring for the destitute and hopeless. I think of people like Princess Diana, not afraid in the conventional sense, and yet prepared to hold the hand of the AIDS patient at the time when sufferers from that condition were spurned and feared. I think of a church I read about that not only provides a weekly meal for the homeless, but has installed showers in the church building so that these people can maintain a sense of human dignity. I think of many more examples, more than I can tell you about this morning. Saints who've not feared the ugly or been appalled by the unclean, but have reached out with God's tender. tender, loving touch. And of course, for any saint, this is hardly surprising, for each one recognised that they followed a Lord who himself is hardly an epitome of beauty. But he himself was blooded and sweaty and twisted in tortured agony on the cross, also the weak and know the blessing of eternal life. And so this Halloween, this festival of all saints, let's not fear the ugly, or be repelled by the distasteful, or turn away when we see sights that leave us feeling uncomfortable, but rather let us, by trying to amend the saints, throw off them of those outdated, unhelpful ways of seeing the world, and reach out instead to all people with God's blessings of everlasting love. Amen.
All fights in the midst of this divine. Thank you. The Lord.